views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hi, and welcome to BronxNet's live coverage of City Hall in your borough. I'm BronxNet correspondent Darissa White. Wednesday, Mayor Bill de Blasio and Cultural Affairs Commissioner Tom Finkelpearl announced the selection of 10 new and expanded partnerships for funding under the Mayor's Grant for Cultural Impact, or MGCI. MGCI's initiative is to provide grants of $50,000 to arts and cultural organizations working in partnership with city agencies. One major goal of MGCI is to create arts and cultural opportunities for underserved populations in New York in an effort to improve the social well-being of low-income communities in areas of public health and safety, domestic violence, literacy, planning, immigration, and criminal justice. Lehman College is hosting today's live event, City Hall in your borough, where the Mayor's Office of Cultural Affairs will announce 10 new recipients of the grant. We will also see performances by the People's Theater Project and a spoken word by Jessica Balderrama, a writer and content creator born in Mexico and raised in Queens. Join us now as we head over to Lehman College Multimedia Center for the live press conference.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Lehman College. Now in the midst of a year-long celebration of the 50th anniversary of the founding of our institution in the Bronx. My name is Peter Mwosu. I am Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs and Student Success at our great institution. I bring you greetings on behalf of our president, Dr. Jose Luis Cruz, who is away from the campus attending another event. I also bring you greetings on behalf of our faculty, our staff, our students, and the alumni of this great institution. Although they will be introduced shortly, I want to especially thank Tom Finkelpearl, who is the commissioner of our city's cultural affairs unit. I also want to extend welcome to Anne de Castillo, who is also acting commissioner in the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment. And certainly welcome Jennifer Egan, who is Pulitzer Prize winning author and PEN America board president, for joining us today. The Lehman College community is so pleased and proud to be part of an announcement that signals hope and compassion to the 800,000 undocumented youth called Dreamers here in our country. It is so fitting that this event is taking place here this afternoon at this campus, at this institution which has served as the home for the United Nations shortly after its founding. And our campus's namesake, Herbert H. Lehman, fought throughout his lifetime for the most noble of humanitarian causes. The news that PEN America, an organization that celebrates the free expression of individuals around the world, and the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment are setting up writing workshops for Dreamers stands as a truly shining example of a public-private collaboration that will generate much-needed support for many of our friends and neighbors. Knowing that these workshops aim to give Dreamers a safe and meaningful platform for their voices, as well as proving ground to improve their storytelling abilities, makes so much sense. Their stories deserve and need to be heard. That a talent pipeline to the publishing industry is also being created within this initiative seems extraordinarily forward-thinking. Now, as the status of undocumented individuals becomes more familiarized across our communities, we will be helping to spread future prosperity at the same time. The issue here in our country, and increasingly in countries around the world, of illegal immigration evokes strong opinions. Here, there is a general agreement that the system of legal immigration with a guaranteed path to citizenship, if desired, is broken. The broken system, of course, is not the fault of hundreds of thousands of individuals who have fled their countries because of war, because of violence, political persecution, hunger, or even natural disaster. Indeed, people have been journeying around the world for the very same reason since the beginning of humankind. For dreamers and others brought into our nation as children, their undocumented status is simply an artifact of our country's long-standing role as a beacon of hope. Amid the anti-immigration raids and deportations of our current administration's efforts at the federal level, though, a cruel policy that upends lives and fractures the trust and cohesion of our communities, we need to reassert and uphold this nation's long-held values of freedom and liberty. And rather than let some choose political expediency over these sacred values and use dreamers as a bargaining chip, giving our dreamers an opportunity to articulate their humanity and share their experiences with all of us is a great way to educate and inform communities across our country about how our friends and neighbors are being oppressed and how they are continuing to journey on. So a big thank you to PEN America, a big thank you to the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, plus congratulations to all of the institutions hosting the new workshops for this enlivening breath of hope and compassion. And now it is my privilege to introduce to you one of those young writers, Yessica Balderrama, who is also a content creator. Yessica was born in Mexico. She was raised in Queens. She speaks four languages, four, and aspires to keep learning more. Think of our experiences coming to our country. All she asks is an opportunity to continue to learn. Her work has been featured on WNYC. Her work has been featured on the Third Coast International Audio Festival. And currently, she's also enrolled in the Dreaming Out Loud program. Please join me in welcoming Yessica.
I'm going to be reading an essay that I wrote after attending the Kavanaugh protest in October. The menacing Capitol building loomed in the distance. Flimsy metal barricades separated protesters from the Capitol building steps in a pristine lawn. We were asked to stand behind the fence with other protesters. Attending the protest against the appointment of Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court in Washington, D.C. with brick by brick had been a last-minute decision. I knew it could potentially trigger my PTSD, and I risked arrest. I arrived at Washington, D.C. in time for the demonstrations at the Senate's offices. On the first day, we went to the Senate Hart Building lobby and formed a human wall by standing side by side in a line. There were 13 of us, and we were asked to leave just minutes after standing. Two more warnings would have gotten us arrested with a $50 bail for each person. On a second day, brick by brick was down to four people. Those of us left were not discouraged and went to protest on the steps of the Supreme Court. After 10 minutes of standing, we were again asked to leave. The week of the Kavanaugh trial, I tried to avoid watching the news. The outcome of similar past cases told me I should not watch reports unless I too wanted to be outraged. I did not need to watch the news to know what was happening with updates flooding my social media accounts. Terms such as sexual assault, victim, and perpetrator glaringly peppered web pages. How to escape the overwhelming feelings of panic these words incited. How to run away from the past when the past is in you and a core component of the person you are today. At the Supreme Court, countless of other protesters sat behind us on the steps and below a speaker spoke into a microphone to large crowds on the street. Onlookers surrounded us after the first warning from a police officer. After a second warning from a less forgiving police officer, we were warned if we did not leave, we would be arrested. One of the protesters insisted we cooperate to not put my safety at risk. I am a dreamer and I run the risk of deportation if detained protesting. I offered to step down alone to keep the protests going and they stepped down with me. This gesture of sympathy was a realization that I was not alone. I had support and community, comfort I had been deprived of most of my life as an undocumented immigrant living on the fringe. Not only am I an undocumented Hispanic woman, I'm also queer and closeted to most of my traditional Catholic family. I still remember the first time I was called a dyke at school before I knew what it meant. I opened my mouth and I spoke American English without an accent, but the color of my skin gave me away. Were these secrets scribbled across my face like magic marker? Could strangers detect my true identity? The slurs beaner, fence hopper, and criminal echoed in my mind. As I remembered these memories on the steps of the Supreme Court, I wanted to hide. My legs trembled and I took deep breaths. Groups of people took pictures of us and smiled. I wondered if the women on either side of me felt my sweaty palms and shaky fingers. I felt dizzy and nauseous after the results of the trial were announced. Flashbacks of childhood sexual abuse came to mind as I gulped back tears. I resolved not to cry as I stared straight ahead into the distance, and to my surprise, my eyes and throat were dry. There were no tears left, only the weariness I had grown accustomed to feeling in place of the melodrama of sadness. This was not the first time or will be the last time my story or someone else's story of abuse will be denied or questioned. I did not tell my mother what had happened until 2 years of living in this country. My relatives said I had imagined it. After the protests, I reflected on what had happened. I cried for all the victims who spoke into microphones and publicly shared their stories. I fell to the painful heaviness of their silence, of being neglected and ignored by family members for months or years, until it was too late for the abuse not to leave a permanent mark. Their stories were similar to mine and followed a familiar pattern. In no other place outside of group therapy had I ever heard anyone else share their story. Hearing other women share their stories of sexual abuse at the Kavanaugh protest relieved a part of me that had always felt alone despite being aware of the prevalence of sexual abuse. It had taken me 13 years to share my story with friends I trusted and another 5 to go to therapy. Unlike other survivors of childhood sexual abuse, I was lucky to leave my hometown and be far away from my perpetrator. If I had stayed in Mexico, would it have continued? Most likely. The women present at Washington, D.C. with me had been silenced as well. Now we could speak. Now we could let others know. We were together and this unity transcended the present moment to heal old forgotten wounds. Freedom is defined as the power or right to act, speak, or think as one wants without hindrance or restraint. By this definition, no undocumented person is free in this country. We cannot do anything that may risk detention. Why would I risk my safety to go to protest? For once, I wanted to feel as if I was in control of my future and had a say in what happened to me. The semblance of freedom was better than nothing. Each election I watched as strangers who may or may not be aware about the lacking rights of undocumented immigrants cast ballots to decide my future. For the past 2 years, I have had a heightened awareness of being an illegal alien in America. I have become increasingly worried about being arrested or attracting unnecessary attention from the law. How to be free while living with the burden of being undocumented. The constant worry of being made to leave the country. What was freedom and who was it for? I had been attending protests for nearly 6 years and was always careful not to get into trouble. The fear of getting arrested as an undocumented immigrant had ceased to faze me. Was I careless? What was the worst that could happen? When people said I was brave, I did not know what to respond. Being undocumented was not a choice. I could only choose to accept it. But if you are undocumented and a victim of abuse, should you stay quiet? Standing to demonstrate in front of the Supreme Court was one of the few times I have felt free in this country. This simple act bestowed me with visibility and vulnerability I had not experienced at any other time in my life. I was not tucked away into a drawer and hidden as I had always been instructed to do. This was loudness made visible. My existence in itself was a form of protest against a government threatening us into secrecy and fear. I was present and heard without making a sound.
Wow, that was really powerful. Jessica, that's just beautifully written. I want to just say that's important to me, as we're going to talk about writing, et cetera. But just this is part of dreaming out loud, and I think that's a perfect way. Those words make a lot of sense in terms of what you just said. So I just, can we just have another round of applause for Jessica? And I just, having spent 24 years of my adult life in Queens, here is a spirit of Queens personified in a young woman. So just fantastic. Okay. So I just want to thank everybody for being here. I want to thank you for joining us, both in person. I know it's super hard because it's so cold. I know some people actually didn't make it because of the flu, et cetera. But I want to thank Peter and Lehman College. I was saying before, my dad taught here. I was when I was a kid, my dad, tell you the story that he was teaching in a perfectly comfortable tenured job at Vassar, and he said, I got to get to where interesting things are happening with amazing students. Quit the job, came and taught at Lehman College, and just loved it. And I, myself, am a proud CUNY graduate, so I want to say that we're very proud to be here at a CUNY institution. And happy to be here in the Bronx. This week is what's called City Hall in Your Borough Week. So the mayor and all the city, you know, all the different commissioners are up here in the Bronx doing great stuff. So I want to give you some background. We're going to get back to Penn in a minute. So we did a cultural plan for New York City where we traveled all over the city. We had hundreds and hundreds of meetings with 25,000 people. And one of the things that was said was you got to connect city government agencies better to the people of New York and better to the cultural institutions. So that was something we took to heart, and that the development of this grant, which we're going to talk about here today, it's called the Mayor's Grant for Cultural Impact, came directly out of that, what we heard from the people in New York City. So the model here is that we give grants to cultural institutions, and a bunch of them are in the room, I'm going to introduce you in a minute, to work with city agencies. And so that's what we'll talk about a little bit. But so it's a way to close the gap between city agencies and cultural institutions and the city of New York. So we have, this is the second year, so this is a celebration. We started it last year with a group of organizations, five of which were so unbelievable that we had to give them a second year. So five groups are in, and you'll understand what the partnerships are if I just go through and tell you a little bit what's happened. So here are the five that we are renewing, and then there are five new ones. The Bronx Documentary Center collaborated with the MOCJ, Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice, and it's called Claremont Illuminated, using literary light, literally using light to light up public spaces. Are there people here from Bronx Documentary Center? No? So it was an amazing event. We went to this last year, and we saw how they had cleaned up and worked in a space and sort of illuminated it with photographs taken by folks in the community. Gibney Dance is working with the Mayor's Office to End Domestic and Gender-Based Violence. It's called Hands for Holding, teaching young people about healthy relationships through dance. Carnegie Hall has a longstanding collaboration with the Department of Probation. They're working in their NEON, Neighborhood Opportunity Networks, and its apprenticeship program. So I know people are here from Carnegie Hall and from probation. And the National Book Foundation is working with DYCD, Department of Youth and Community Development, project is called Raising Readers, Inspiring the Love of Reading in Parents so that they can inspire their kids. And finally, and we're going to hear from them a little bit later, People's Theaters Project has been working with the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs. And it is a series of performances, which you're going to hear a little bit more about, which is young people spreading the word about Moya's services through theater. And so, you know, it's interesting because there are a lot of different ways in which an agency like Moya, that's the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, communicates. But, you know, there are other ways around corners that artists and arts organizations understand. So that's what we've been doing in our first year. And our second year, we have five new grantees. So this is the new ones are Concerts in Motion, Department of the Aging, which is that collaboration is hosting over 100 concerts at NORCS. Do you people know what NORCS is? A naturally occurring retirement community. Throughout the city. Irondale Productions is going to be working with the police department and creating connections between cops and community members through role-playing and theater. They have a model where they do equal number of community members and police officers and folks from police department and collaboratively create theater opportunities or theater performances. Weeksville Heritage Center is working with CCHR, that's Human Rights. It's an oral history project documenting the evolution of Bed-Stuy through food, which is creativity as well. Willie Mae Rock Camp for Girls and the Department of Homeless Services is working together. And it's Rhythm and Voice, an after-school music and mentoring program for young people and families at a family shelter in Canarsie. These are all important locations throughout the city. You know, it's our great privilege as city employees to really get to see the city, borough, from the top of the Bronx to the bottom of Staten Island, and that's what's happening in all of these. So to get back to Penn, I'd like Acting Commissioner Anne Del Castillo to come up. Now, this was going to be your previous commissioner's last day at the work, right? But she's sick. So you're Acting Commissioner already? Okay, good. Tomorrow. Okay, well, I'm going to say you're starting today because Julie Menon, Commissioner of Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, is out sick with the flu. Sorry not to be here, but come on up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. And thank you to Provost Wusu and Lehman College, and especially thanks to Yeska for sharing that powerful story. Good afternoon, everyone. Couldn't be pleased that my first official event as Acting Commissioner of the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment is to celebrate these visionary cultural impact grants with you. Our agency serves the creative industries of New York and supports all of the different ways that New Yorkers tell their stories, from filmmaking to journalism to podcasting and, of course, book publishing. We are thrilled that our partnership with PEN America to expand the Dreaming Out Loud program was one of the 10 chosen to receive the Mayor's Cultural Impact Grant. Dreaming Out Loud is a tuition-free program that encourages dreamers like Yesica to write and share their stories in a safe space, encourages them to develop their voice and craft, helps build a diverse pipeline of talent for the publishing industry, and reveals more nuanced portraits of our city's immigrant communities. Dreaming Out Loud has already empowered Caribbean and Latinx students to write about their experiences and hone their storytelling skills. With this grant, PEN America will expand the program to reach dreamers in the Chinese, African, and Eastern European communities, and partner with more CUNY campuses, including right here at Lehman. I'm delighted to be making this announcement with PEN America's board president, Jennifer Egan, who, among her many accolades, was selected as last year's winner of our One Book, One New York contest for her novel, Manhattan Beach. Jennifer is a great friend to our agency, and Penn America has been an extraordinary partner. Among Penn's numerous efforts to advance freedom of expression, they have successfully been creating safe spaces where marginalized and unfairly stigmatized people can tell their stories. Penn's work speaks directly to our commitment at the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment to foster inclusivity across the creative industries. We believe that New Yorkers from all backgrounds should benefit from the growth of the creative industries in New York City, and we believe that everyone benefits when these industries are more inclusive. At this moment in history, it has never been more crucial to amplify the voices of undocumented immigrants. We cannot allow them to be intimidated into silence. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce Pulitzer Prize and One Book winning author, Penn America's Board President, Jennifer Egan.
Thank you, Commissioner Del Castillo. Penn America stands at the intersection of literature and free expression to celebrate the power of writing to change the world. I'm honored to serve as its president. One of our most dynamic programs embodying every aspect of our mission is Dreaming Out Loud, our tuition-free writing workshops for undocumented immigrants right here in New York City. This program began in 2016 as a collaboration of CUNY with the novelist Alvaro Enrique, and is now able to expand this semester threefold thanks to the Mayor's Grant for Cultural Impact. The program will help participants develop original writing in a supportive and safe community of peers, guided by mentors who will help them pursue careers in writing and publishing. We at Penn America want to extend our enormous thanks to Mayor de Blasio, the Department of Cultural Affairs, the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, CUNY, Alvaro Enrique, our newest workshop leaders, wonderful authors Lisa Coe and Charlie Vasquez, and of course, the young writers in the program, including Gabby Cervantes, who's here with us today, and who will serve as the program's student leader and coordinator, and participants like Jessica Balderrama, whose wrenching and riveting words we've all just heard. Thank you.
Okay, so I would like to now, so we're gonna have people come up and talk about the individual grantees. So Carmelin, I think we'd like to ask you to come up next. So this is the collaboration between Weeksville Heritage Center and CCHR. Here's the commissioner. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Carmelin P. Malalas. I'm the chair and commissioner for the New York City Commission on Human Rights. We are the city agency that enforces the city's anti-discrimination and anti-harassment protections. It's really a pleasure to be here today for this announcement and to be partnering again with the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs. This is our second collaboration. We also can boast having our first ever artist in residence, thanks to the support of the Department of Cultural Affairs. So the commission is thrilled to be here as a recipient of the Mayor's Grant for Cultural Impact. Our partner, as was announced earlier, is the Weeksville Heritage Center. They could not make it here today, but we are very excited to be working with them to allow the Commission on Human Rights and Weeksville Heritage Center to embark on a journey of cultural preservation. In our study that is called Meals as Collective Memory, Black-owned restaurants in a changing central Brooklyn. There's obviously a lot of change happening in a lot of the city's neighborhoods, and at the Commission on Human Rights, we are very interested on the different impacts it has for especially some of the city's most vulnerable populations. Since before the Civil War, African Americans have comprised the largest segment of central Brooklyn's residents, sharing many distinctive cultural markers, and of course, not least among them is food. Mom-and-pop restaurants of this area serve not only as good places to eat, but serve as gathering places, community centers, and cultural touchstones for the neighborhoods. Gentrification of this historically Black area threatens the existence of many of these spaces. And the Commission and Weeksville Heritage Center will, through this fantastic program, and through the collection of oral history interviews, be able to document, preserve, share, and debate what happens to this community's cultural identity in the face of this changing neighborhood. I want to say thanks again to the mayor's office and to DCLA for this opportunity. I want to say congratulations to the other recipients. You know, New York City is, of course, what I think of as being kind of the capital of an ethos of human rights, of really thinking through the many ways in which we foster diversity and inclusion in our neighborhoods. And certainly this program is just another way that we do that here in the city. So thank you very much.
So thank you, Commissioner, for thanking me. But I wanted to I do this at almost every event. It's not my money. It is the taxpayers of New York City's money. So I just want to thank everybody in the audience who pay taxes in New York City and everybody who's watching on TV. So look, can we have a hand for the taxpayers of New York City? All right. Thank you, and we take very seriously how we spend this money. I think it's a very good use of the money. Okay, next. There's a collaboration between Concerts in Motion and Department for the Aging, another great collaborator for the Department of Cultural Affairs, Jennifer Finn. If you could come up. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm the founder and executive director of Concerts in Motion. We are 10 years old this year. Over the last 10 years, we've been slowly but surely growing our partnership with the Department for the Aging, because what we do is we bring tailored live music performed by top professionals from our city who we pay to do these concerts. We serve every borough of our city. This year, we will do 1,200 concerts. And this project has been a real game changer for us because it has helped us to reach now 25 naturally occurring retirement communities. We've now scheduled 128 concerts. We anticipate doing as many as 200 concerts in the five-month window of the project, and we will reach an additional 1,000 older adult residents. These concerts are tailored, meaning the agency requests the genre, and our musicians, who are over 100 strong, play every genre. So we have everything from Chinese classical, Russian, R&B, Motown, everything they ever would love to have. And each concert includes a group concert for the community. And then our signature program is actually our musicians leave the group concert and they go to two apartments to perform for older residents who have a hard time leaving their homes to attend the group concert. So we find that it's a real community builder, especially when the musicians share that they'll now be visiting their neighbors who couldn't come to the concert. So we are very grateful for this opportunity and so grateful to the Department for the Aging for partnering with us. So thank you very much.
Okay, so Willie May and Department of Homeless Services. I'm asking Jennifer Kessler to come up. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Jennifer Kessler. I'm the executive director of Willie May Rock Camp for Girls. And on behalf of the board, staff, families, and everyone at Willie May Rock Camp, I am thrilled to be here to accept the mayor's grant for cultural impact from the Department of Cultural Affairs. So Willie May Rock Camp was started about 14 years ago by a group of New York City female musicians, and to offer transformative music and social justice programming for girls. We're named after the blues and rock musician Willie May Big Mama Thornton, and we believe that all girls and gender expansive youth should have opportunities for self-expression, strengthening self-confidence, and learning that they can use their voices to make the change in the world that they want to see. And we do this with the premise that anybody can learn enough drums, bass, guitar, vocals, keys, DJing to write original music and perform after a very short period of time. So we are thrilled to partner with the Department of Homeless Services to work with youth at the Flatlands Family Shelter as an outcome of this grant. This is part of our vision and our strategic plan to reach many more girls and gender expansive youth in New York City. And we're going to be offering an original music writing workshop, songwriting workshop for the youth there, in which they're going to learn performance skills, songwriting skills, and perhaps also recording. I just want to thank everyone at the Department of Homeless Services, and thank you very much to the Mayor's Office and Create NYC for your investment in youth and the arts. We are thrilled to be a part of this extraordinary community of change makers who are developing creative agency for New York City's youth. Thank you.
Okay, next is Carnegie Hall and Department of Probation, Ayanna Cole and Katrina Prelo. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Ayanna Cole. I'm Assistant Director of Social Impact Programs at Carnegie Hall. I'm really excited to be here with my colleague, Katrina Prelu, from the Director of the Neighborhood Opportunity Network with the New York City Department of Probation. I think we flipped a coin to see who was going to speak, and depending on how you look at it, I either lost or I won. So we work together delivering a program called Neon Arts. Neon Arts is free creative arts workshops across New York City for young people. It's also a granting program that provides funds to artists and arts organizations to produce programs in partnership with the Neons across New York City. So this year, this award will support paid apprenticeships and paid internships for young people across four of our Neon sites in the Bronx, in Brooklyn, in Jamaica, and in Staten Island. And they'll support 13 paid apprenticeships. And so current Neon Arts participants, usually between the ages of 16 and 24 years old, are eligible to apply for these positions. And they'll work with our stakeholders across New York City. And again, in Neon Arts, neither Carnegie Hall nor the New York City Department of Probation decides how the granting works with artists. The neighborhoods themselves select the artists through the grant applications. And so these young people will also work collaboration with the stakeholders. And so, we're just really excited about Neon Arts. It's a unique opportunity for a law enforcement agency and a cultural institution to work together in this way, and particularly with such a strong voice from the neighborhoods. It's really important to us that the neighborhoods direct and dictate how this program manifests across the city. So we're really excited. Thank you to Mayor de Blasio, to Commissioner Finkelpearl, to the Department of Cultural Affairs, and congratulations to all the other grantees today. Thank you.
Yeah, it's just inspiring to hear everybody talk. We have two more groups that are going to come up. So this is Gibney and the Mayor's Office to End Gender-Based Violence. Could we have Kara Gilmore and Sarah Gonzalez?
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. It is an honor to be here today with you all. My name is Cara Gilmore, and I'm a senior director at Gibney Dance. We're an arts organization that is dedicated to making space for dance, both inside and outside the studios. And it is an honor to be here with my colleague, Sarah Gonzalez, from the Mayor's Office to End Domestic and Gender-Based Violence. We've actually worked together for many years on a number of initiatives to really focus on the prevention as well as prevention of violence, as well as utilizing the creative process to really engage choice making, creative expression, and self-empowerment. And this grant was, it was monumental in the way that it allowed us to expand our programming, working with particularly middle school students to bring our Hands Are for Holding program into schools throughout the five boroughs. But it was also an incredible validation of the work that we've been doing and saying that art matters in a way that is more than just nice, but it is crucial to creating systemic change and having the work and the connections with the NGBV really allowed us to grow our program through access to different schools and different organizations in a way that we couldn't have without really that infusion of accreditation that the city gives you as a partner. And so I think that that is was hugely important to us, as well as just the honor of working with our colleagues at NGBV, whom we adore. And we were able to not only create this program for middle schools or expand it, but we did uniquely create a 10-week residency program for kids, offering both creative expression tools as well as anti-violence tools to become the leaders themselves, to really be leading this conversation. So thank you so much, and it really is an honor to work with you all. And I'll turn it over to Sarah to tell a little bit more.
Hello, Sarah Gonzalez. I was actually at the beginning of the assembly creation for Hands Are for Holding, and I just wanted to come here today to talk about the impact that I've seen it have on young people specifically. I'll try not to get emotional. With the assembly, for example, the setup is the dancers will dance, and then we'll have an educator come out and talk about what was seen, what's a healthy relationship, what's intimate partner violence, what are the different types of abuse, how do we help our friends who may be experiencing these relationships. And there was this one time that Gimme will ask young people to also come up onto the stage to be able to perform certain aspects of the dance. And it's, I won't mirror it for you, but they sit on the floor back to back, and they have to be able to support each other equally to rise without using their hands. And they'll have a few groups come up. And there was this one group who just couldn't, well, this one pair that just couldn't get it. And what happened next is the part that always gets me emotional, because not only did everyone who accomplished it form like a circle around them, everyone in the audience started to cheer them on. It's happening again. I'm not sorry, because we should not be shameful of emotions and tears. But it showed me the possibilities of healthy relationships. And I took that moment to talk to them and say, this is what advocating for healthy relationships and ending domestic violence looks like. It's a community. When we see someone working and trying to have it, we don't shame them, we circle them, and we show them the love, and we help them, and we give them tips and things like that. And that was with an assembly of, I would say, maybe like 150 to 200 young people in the space. And that led way for us to be able to have the residencies, which are a lot more intimate, and our educators are working with them primarily to also talk about what is healthy relationships. And when we did our post-evaluations, one of them said that every middle school should be able to experience it. And then once we're done with middle school, we should go to high school because they needed to. So I just wanted to, once again, thank you for this opportunity for us to continue to do the work with young people.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. And then, Eileen, if you could join me up here. I think we're going to be speaking as they're beginning to set up. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yes. Okay, so People's Theater Project will begin to set up as we are hearing from Eileen, and then we'll talk a little bit further. Go ahead.
Okay,
yes.
Great. Thank you, Tom. So grateful to be here at Lehman College, here in the Bronx during City Hall in your borough. I want to thank Commissioner Finkelpearl and the staff of DCLA. We're so grateful to have received this grant in the first year, and are so excited to form part of the list of agencies that are coming back for a second year. This renewed partnership will really allow us to leverage and expand the work that we've done in the past year. It's been incredible also to work with Mino and Bob and Safi and the rest of the team at the People's Theater Project. Using theater as our medium through the unique lens of social justice movements has informed the development of Teatro Emigrante Comunitario. It has allowed us to reach immigrant youth in this city, a population that the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs is really interested in reaching more of. Through this partnership, we have directly served immigrant youth ages 16 to 23 who received a comprehensive training on MOYA's programs and services. They've used poetry, movement, spoken word, music, and comedy to develop an ensemble-based performance piece that explores the modern immigrant experience here in New York City. through these performances, primarily in Spanish, and performed to Spanish-speaking audiences, we have reached a total of over 700 people. Through Teatro Inmigrante Comunitario, we have been able to provide participating youth with a platform from which they have been able to develop and grow as individuals and further amplify their voices. We have armed them with the information they need to make decisions that positively impact their families, and have empowered them to share the knowledge with their broader communities, educating them on the programs that the city provides, to make sure that, you know, people understand that the city provides services for every New Yorker, regardless of your immigration status. We very much look forward to developing a new set of performances that will further highlight the experiences of immigrant youth throughout the five boroughs. And I know that they're setting up now the performance that they're getting ready to share with all of us. It's an original play. It was created by a group of all immigrant women, and it's really speaking to and responding to the changes in federal government as it relates to the zero tolerance policy. This particular branch of the People's Theater Project speaks perfectly to their mission of using theater to tell their collective stories and to build the next generation of leaders, and is also part of what inspired the partnership that exists now through the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and the People's Theater Project. Thank you.
Now, we want some people to come and sit in these chairs, right?
Yes.
Okay, audience members, I need your attention for a second. And city agencies, this is not, you're not going to be asked to participate, but this is, come on up. Can we have some people come up and sit in these chairs, please? And so it's the performance occurs in the round, so we need people to be around the performers. We need three or four more people. Please come up. Thank you. Okay, and by the way, I just wanted to, you're going to take away the, yeah, can I take this? Okay. In case Mina Laura, the director of People's Theaters Project, who is sick in bed, is watching, I just wanted to shout out to her as well. She is watching in bed. Okay. So are you ready to start, or should I buy a little bit more time? Okay, we need some people here.
Yes.
Audience members, come on, please. Maybe I'll sit over there. Is that, we're going to save that for me? Okay. We're good?
Yes, and I okay. also want to say that this is just 7 minutes of a 45 minutes play. Okay. So you're just going to see a little bit.
All right, so I should hand this back to you. Okay.
Mi nombre es
Kat Peña,
María Peira Maure,
Angie Regina,
María José Fajardo,
Kimberly Gómez.
I am from Colombia,
Dominican Republic,
España y México.
I came to the United States.
I came to the United States.
In 2003.
Back in 2010.
Back in 2003.
In 2010.
El 1995.
With my mom and my sister.
Sola. Y embarazada.
Con toda mi familia.
By myself. Because it was safer.
Por cambios de gobierno.
Porque mis padres me trajeron.
Because I wanted to start a new life.
Because it was safer for my family to return.
The journey was...
Inesperado.
Exciting.
Uncertain.
Sad. I don't remember.
I miss Bongo.
My mom.
Life there. Not having to explain my culture. 45 children are separated from their parents every day.
Thousands of refugees travel 2,000 miles to the U.S. border in hopes of earning asylum.
Esta administración presidencial ha separado estimadamente 2,000 niños de sus padres y sigue sumando.
Family separation can lead to a post-traumatic stress disorder.
Hundreds of these children are under the age of 4.
This is... Las Mariposas,
a play based on true stories.
A play based on true stories.
On true stories. The play starts back home.
Antes de ir.
Antes de llegar.
Places.
Un, dos, tres, cuatro.
Ay, Miriam, mi niña linda.
Ay, ¿cuántos años tienes, ah?
¿Ah? No me lo diga, es un secretico.
Ay, abuelita tan linda.
Ay, Tiaguito, bueno, me voy a acostar porque ya tengo que tomarme mis pastillas. Good night, Nagu.
Mami.
¿Qué?
¿Dónde están los cucharones?
Ay, pues no sé.
Mami.
¿Qué?
Que tengo hambre, ¿dónde están los cucharones?
Ay, que no sé, carajo.
Ay, olvídelo.
Ay, Dios mío, pero esta niña sí está bella.
Sí, parece que fue ayer que te bauticé.
Ay, madrina, qué sombrero más lindo.
Ay, la última moda en París.
¡Que comience la fiesta!
Ven acá, mira, ven acá, ven acá. Ay, ay, ay.
Mira,
te dije que adentro de la casa,
no.
Pasa. Ya,
ya.
Miriam. Ay, ay. Una quinceañera.
Por si acaso no regreso.
¿Y aquí? ¿Quién no me invitó a la fiesta?
Ay, pero Vanessa, niña, estamos en familia.
Ay,
la blusa.
Pero yo estoy de familia, yo soy familia. No, vamos, doña, vamos a bailar.
No, mi hija. Pum,
pum,
pum. Deja, mami, tranquila.
Ay, Dios mío, ven, ven, niño, entonces, vamos a enseñarle a bailar.
¡Sube la música!
¿Verdad?
Ay, ay, ay.
Comprender.
Ay, no sé cómo.
Pensé que en cualquier momento a tu suelo iba a volver. Pero el tiempo va pasando.
Que me baje la música.
Pero es temprano.
Ay, señor policía, es que es mi cumpleaños. ¿Quiere una tortica o una Coca-Colita?
O me bajan la música. O se van presos todos.
Y bájeme la falda esa y súbeme la música.
Ay, ay, ay. Una vuelta, aquí vamos.
Guardaremos los rencores, Dios mío.
Y así
compartiremos
la
we'll stay here for this. So I'm just going to wrap it up. I just wanted to say that, you know, just watching, hearing from everybody and the incredibly moving, first speech, I'm still thinking about that. I think that some of the content of the work that's being done by People of the Sierras Project is very, very related to that. I've been to performances that then go on to explain, actually, in sort of this kind of cool theatrical way, city services and how you can actually access those services for immigration. But there's so many different issues in the city and so many issues that different parts of this initiative are addressing. Again, I can just imagine what it's going to be like to be in that shelter, a homeless shelter, and experiencing art and culture. And every single person deserves arts and culture in their life. And I don't care if you're a homeless person in Brooklyn or you're whatever you're experiencing. And I think that we have to understand as a city and as city agencies, and I think it's really obvious from the incredible number of really great applicants we got, actually. So congratulations to the agencies who got it, and you know, regrets to the ones that didn't. But there's a need and an understanding that arts and culture can communicate in a different way that's also extremely important, that gets to your heart and also inspires action. So I just wanted to say thank you to everybody. It's really inspiring to me. Again, don't thank me, thank the cultures. But thanks. Can we have another hand for the People Theater Project? And with that, I think we're going to wrap it up. So I don't know if you're cutting away to a different report at this moment, but that's it for this event. So really, thank you, everybody, for coming. And I hope everybody can meet each other as well. That's quite important. Thank you very much.
Thanks for joining us. For more information about the initiative, you can visit www.nyc.gov. Again, my name is Darissa White for BronxNet Television.